This is a stimulus check update, October 21st, 2020. Let's get it. All right, ML family, thank you for joining me once again here on this beautiful day on the ML family YouTube channel. Welcome, welcome, welcome for all of you that's new. Go ahead and give this video a big thumbs up by hitting that like button. Subscribe so you can become a permanent part of the ML family. Turn the post notifications on so that you can be notified every time an updated post comes through for stimulus or whatever content I post. So, make sure you drop a comment, share, check the description, where I will leave my TikTok, Instagram, Facebook, and my Twitter, Snapchat. Also, if you'd like to donate to my channel and support, I also put in my Cash App and my PayPal. In this video, there are two interviews, two articles. The interviews will come after this. Go ahead and make sure that you stay tuned and check those out. I love y'all. God bless. Stay safe. Social distance. Wear a mask. Wash your hands. Sanitize. Make sure you check out those interviews and watch them to their entirety so you can see what's going on. Democrats have voted down the GOP bill. 51-44. It is what it is. So make sure you stay tuned and check it out.
Kelly, Senate Republicans have failed to advance their roughly $500 billion package of targeted coronavirus relief. They needed 60 votes in order to clear a key procedural hurdle. The Democrats voted against this en masse, and so the measure failed to move forward. Back over to you.
Was this a surprise, Elon?
No, this was the expected outcome, Kelly. This was really set up as a sort of messaging vote for Republicans to show where their priorities were and to force Democrats to vote against it. So we will see if this really is the last vote that the Senate takes on another COVID relief package. But for now, this measure does not go forward.
And was this the second of the two votes they had this week, Elon?
It was. They took another vote yesterday on extending the payroll protection program. That vote also failed to move forward, blocked by Democrats. So these were two key priorities for both the administration. The PPP was a priority for the White House. This was a priority for Senate Republicans. But both of them, as expected, not moving forward as the White House and House Speaker Nancy Pelosi continue to try to negotiate that broader deal.
The director, of course, of the National Economic Council. Larry, welcome back.
Thank you, Kelly.
Let me start with whether we're going to have another relief bill, as I like to call it, on the COVID front. It does seem, to quote a lot of the D.C. people we talked to yesterday, they said, listen, with how vicious this fight over the Supreme Court seat is going to be, there's no way Congress is going to compromise on this bill now. Do you think that analysis is right?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I don't want to get ahead of it. You can walk and chew gum at the same time. So it's not necessarily a given. But look, as you just heard Secretary Mnuchin, it's important from the administration, from the president's standpoint, we have been asking for five or six assistance programs. I don't think that V-shaped recovery depends on the package, but I do think a targeted package could be a great help. In shorthand, we call it kids and jobs. We wanted additional funds, for example, I believe $105 billion, Kelly, all along, to help open the schools, any, you know, costs that are necessary for safety and security to help open the schools, which is absolutely vital for education, for psychology, for the economy. Second, we've also wanted to extend the assistance plan, the PPP plan, to small businesses. I mean, we actually had money, I don't know, it's over $100 billion
right,
that could be repurposed to go back into that plan. I think the plan was very effective. I think it did save perhaps 50 million jobs, and I think it's helping folks get back to work, you know, better unemployment numbers than we suspected. So those are just two items. There are other items that we were happy to look at, but unfortunately we couldn't reach agreement with the other side. And so that was before the judicial issues came up. So I'm just saying, I don't think one depends on the other. I just think we were at a stalemate, and I wish we could break the stalemate, because even though I think the economy is improving nicely, it could use help in some key targeted places.
Larry, what do you think the macro impact is going to be? Let's say the Supreme Court seat is filled in the next couple of months by Republicans. What is the market's impact? What is the economic impact likely to be over the next 5, 10, 15 years, do you think?
Well, that's a hard question, Kelly. I mean, I think you're going to get a conservative jurist. I think that the president is acting correctly with the Senate, Senate Leader McConnell. I don't know. I mean, in economic terms, and I don't want to go too deep into this. I'm not a judicial Supreme Court expert. I'm just saying in economic terms, I think of, when I look at these nominees for the court, I think of regulatory actions, which come up quite a bit. And I think, as you know, I prefer a lighter touch, a lighter foot on regulatory actions, especially economic regulations. Now, that has been the trend. As you know, the Trump administration has pushed very hard to roll back onerous regulations along with tax cuts, and I hope it's given us tremendous prosperity. So I'm going to assume that the nominee, whoever he or she may be, will continue a lighter touch on regulation. It doesn't mean no regulation. It just means a lighter touch, maybe more sensitivity to business, jobs, and the economy. But that's as far as it would go. I don't think that's going to be a dominant factor in the outlook for the economy over the next longer run.
No, although I take your point that it could take some time to play out. So let me shift back to what looms for the next couple of months. We have not just the kind of need to extend some kind of relief program, and as you've indicated, you guys are looking maybe to some targeted programs, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of them. I don't know whether that could advance, but we also need to cut those CR bills, you know, just the idea of funding the government and keeping it open. Can you explain kind of the politics of this? I mean, which of these are bargaining chips? Is everything on the table now? Or are we going to be able to see kind of those issues dealt with and then the Supreme Court and other things as a separate fight?
Well, I would say separate tracks, Kelly. In other words, the CR, which is necessary to keep the government open, I think Speaker Pelosi and Secretary Mnuchin decided several weeks ago that that would be a clean bill. It would not affect or include any of the potential targeted assistance plans for the broader CARES Act 3, 4, whatever CARES Act we're on. So I think that runs a separate track. I think there's a broad agreement developing on the CR, but it's not completed yet. There are still some matters that are up for grabs. I don't want to interfere with those negotiations. I don't want to speculate. But the CR is to keep the government open. I believe they agreed to mid-December. I think that's what the push is. So that's a good thing. Nobody wants a government shutdown if we can avoid it. That is a separate action from the stimulus conversation, and it's a separate action from the judicial conversation.